Well, good morning and welcome back. It's about 8 o'clock here on a Monday morning in Jupiter. Pretty cold last night. I think it was in the 60s. I know for you people up north, that's not cold at all, but I'm from Miami and that's cold. But it's a beautiful day. There's not a cloud in the sky and the wind has finally died down. So I thought I'd do my next section of plant tours for you. This one's gonna be strictly on palms. I've opened up the camera some to help you see the details. So we might have some blown out skies, or my face might be a little blown out, but it should help you see the detail a little bit better. And also, it's trash day again, so there might be a garbage can or some recycling bins or who knows what else in the background. I'll try and cut it out for you if I can, but anyway, let's get started with our nose is cold. Let's get started with our palms. And I went out last night and actually filmed some on Washingtonians for you, because you don't see those much in residential areas, and they're an important palm around here. So we're going to start here. I know you can see that. That's an old and unidentified Phoenix palm. We'll just let that one go. And of course, there's our stately royals. Now this would probably be a good time to talk about royal palms. There are two kinds of royals. That's the Florida variety. They're native to Florida. They grow down in the Everglades, and they grow along Tamiami Trail, Fakahatchee Strand, Collier Seminole State Park, and places like that. And then there's another one that they call a Cuban royal, and the trunk isn't straight like that. It's a little thinner, more like this one, and about halfway down it has a big bulge. But we don't see those around here very much. So let's go on here and let's see what other palms we can find. These little ones, those are Phoenix Robolinis. They're called dwarf date palms, or pygmy date palms, excuse me. I'll show you a little later. All of the Phoenix palms can be identified by the thorns up on the petiole. And over in the distance, I hope you can see it. You can see that big, great big Bismarckia. And that's across the street from my house. But I mean, it's a towering palm. Again, here's the more of the Phoenix Robolinis. They're really pretty when they're planted in triples like that. And they sort of compete, and there's some curvature in the trunk. They get a little prettier than just a solitary palm. See, he's done it over here too. He's got three palms over there. Okay, so this is an areca palm, and it's a clumping palm. That's what all this is down here. So it's generally used as a screening element more than as a decorative element, because you have to keep the other undergrowth trimmed out. Here's another clump down here. And they can be very messy. These palms across the front, that's called Vicia marilli, or the Christmas palm. And we'll see some more of those. So let's see what other palms we have down here. And there's our friend, the foxtail palm from our last tour. There's another real skinny palm in there. You probably can't see it. I think that's a Tychosperma elegans. And that, of course, is our coconut palm. There's another one in here that I wish I could show you better. It's a clumping fishtail palm. It's Caryota mitens. Mitens is the name, or Caryota urens. I can never keep the two straight. But anyway, one clumps and one doesn't. You hardly ever see the single one that has just a solitary trunk. Now this yard over here, this is a really pretty stand of palms. Look what they've done. They've got some Vicia marilli here. These are all foxtail palms. There's a coconut up in the front. And of course, there's our towering royal. That's a beauty. I think the trunk is so big on that one because there's water right back there. And they love water. Okay, so here is a newly planted hedge of areca palms. I told you it was used to screen a lot. And these have been planted on, looks like they're planted on 2-foot centers. So what that means is they are going to have a monster maintenance problem here in a few years. They're such messy trees down at, they're not such messy palms. There's one on the other block, the guy keeps it trimmed really nicely, I'll show you that. And down at Frenchman's Creek, they use them for a windscreen and noise screen off alternate A1A there. But in fact, here's another hedge. See, they've just put that one in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, those are on about 4-foot centers. Those were bigger plants when they put them in. Again, though, that's gonna be a really great big trimming project. That big clump right there, those are arecas. Kind of an interesting thing about arecas, they're from Madagascar, and the seeds were being collected and sold around the world, and they actually became endangered. You could find them in any nursery, but you couldn't find them in the wild. So I'm on my way back to some more palms. I thought I'd show you this. This is a looks an awful lot like a sable palm, but it's actually a Chinese fan palm. And the giveaway is that the trunk is swollen on the bottom. Sable palms don't do that, and the trunk is much smaller and has a dry, desiccated look to it that sables don't have. Also, I don't know if you can see the seeds up in there. Those are classic Chinese fan palm seeds. Now, I think there's something else I should show you while I'm right here. See what this leaf looks like? See, it's like a palm. Okay, so let's talk about palm leaves. There are two types of, there are four types of palm fronds. You have the classic, like coconut palms or areca palms, where they just have a center rib and then they have frondlets on each side. That's called pinnate. Then you have palms that have a double, instead of just one on each side of the rib, they have two on each side. And that's like our royals and our foxtails. Those are called double pinnate. Then there's another whole nother category of palm fronds shaped like your hand, and they're called palmate. Here's a coke. Let me just show you one other palm before I finish this. That's a bottle palm. I don't know what the Latin name of it is, but there's quite a few in this neighborhood. I think it must have been one of the original plantings that the developers did when they built the place. Anyway, so you have pinnate, double pinnate, palmate, and then there's another variety that your sables and Chinese fan palms, like that one I just showed you, where the frond actually dips down in the middle, and that's called Costa palmate, or sometimes just copalmate. So I'll try and point that out as we go. I'm gonna take you over onto another street where there are a few more palms and the sun is right. And that's the clump of arecas that I told you the guy keeps trimmed, keeps all that undergrowth trimmed out. If you don't want to do that though, don't plant a areca palm. There's that's a Bismarckia that he has in his front yard, and it's just spectacular. But nothing like this other one. Let me show you this. That towering palm right there is a Bismarckia nobilis. They come from Madagascar, like a lot of our trees, a lot of our palms, like arecas and triangle palms. The good thing about them is that they can become just spectacular specimens. They can get to 60 feet tall, which is, you know, pretty like half again as tall as a telephone pole. The bad thing about them is they can get to be 60 feet tall. So you have a huge specimen in your yard like that and it gets hit by lightning. So let's see, we're gonna go around here where the sun is still cool and take a look. There's something I wanna show you over here. They're called triangle palms. There's actually four of them right in this little corner of the neighborhood, which makes me think they may have been part of the original planting. This one's up in the yard, so we'll go down here to the next one. The Latin name for these used to be Neodipsis dicarii. Now it's called Dipsis dicarii. And then there's another one of these bottle palms as well. So there's the triangle palm, and what's interesting about it is the fronds come out on three different planes. There's one going that way, there's one coming toward us, and there's one going that way. That's a pretty good looking example of it. That's the bottle palm over there. Go around the corner here. These triangle palms, here's the other one over here. This one's a little healthier. They fertilize the yard a little more. You can see it a little better with the sun on it. That's a pretty good specimen of a triangle palm. Has kind of a green gray cast of the leaves. You can see it's put out, that's called an inflorescence. What you might think of as a flower spike is called an inflorescence. And there's one more around the corner here. While we're here, let's take a look at this coconut. Coconuts aren't native to West Palm Beach, even though they have got special dispensation to stay. They're no more native than Australian pines are, but the county and the state have decided that they're just going to take them all out. Don't ask me why. Not the palms, the Australian pines. So the way we got Palm Beach is a ship wrecked carrying coconuts and they all washed ashore. So here's what they look like. These would actually be a little bit better late in the afternoon. But there's the royal. And right up here in the front yard, I'm not going to walk up here because these people are home, there's another triangle palm right there. Now he has a couple other things that are interesting. There's one of the bottle palms. And this little clumping palm over here is called a Parotis palm, or sometimes they call them Everglades palms. That's native to Southwest Florida, and that's actually really beautiful. You want to try and get your native plants in if you can, because they don't have insect problems. What that's growing behind them, sometimes you hear that called a traveler's palm. It's really not a palm at all. It's in the banana family, and they call it that because it stores water in the bases of the fronds. Theoretically, that water would keep travelers alive. So let's go on down here. There's another spectacular royal. Let's see. Oh, I wanted to show you this. These are queens. The Latin name for that is Syagrus romanzofiana. And see, when you look at the palms that are available today, these aren't really much to look at. I've got one in my front yard, but when it goes, I'm not going to replace it. Now down here, we're going to run into some Phoenix palms. I think I mentioned to you already that the way you tell your Phoenix palms, first of all, they have pinnate leaves. They can be a single trunk, or they can be clumping. That's a Phoenix, that palm right there. That's either a Phoenix sylvestris or Phoenix dactylifera. I don't know how to tell the difference. And again, there's great big, that has spines up on the petiole, which is what connects the frond to the trunk. They're probably 4 or 5 inches long, and man, are they sharp. Now, let me show you something that is very, very unusual to find. That right there, that small, that is actually a Chamadorea palm. It's called Chamadorea cataractarum. or they sell them as, they call them cat palms. What's interesting about it is a trunkless palm. It clumps from the base, but it never gets any bigger than that. And it could get, you know, a foot taller or a little bit wider, but it's never going to become a tall palm like that. They tried to make a market using them to replace potted areca palms for events like weddings and in churches and stuff. So it's actually part of this house. There's one on the corner. There's another one there. It's really chlorotic. That means yellow. It needs fertilizing. But you can see right here what a role the palms play in the Florida landscape. Let's just start here. There's Chamadoria cataractarum. There's Vicia marilli, the Christmas palm. Those are the Tychosperma elegans. More Christmas palms, coconuts. That's a whole row of sables right there. We go down this way, there's more coconuts, foxtails, queens, royals. There's a big Bismarckia up in the back. And then there are those royals down there. I'm going to show you that in a second, but I wanted to show you this because you keep hearing me talk about areca palms. This is a classic areca windscreen or noise reduction planting. And this is what they really do best. But as you can see, there's a lot of debris on the ground. So you want to put them in, you know, if you had like a lot of land, you wanted to block wind way out there or noise, but they can require a lot of care. And I wanted to show you this. This is kind of a nice little planting. These are Phoenix robolinis. Those are the pygmy date palms that I've talked to you about a couple of times. And she's got a bunch over here in the front. There's a clump of four. So these, when they put palms in clusters like this, they get a little bit of what's called character to them. So the trunks get some curvature. And this would be a good place for me to show you the spines on the... I hope you can see that. Look how long that is. So all of the Phoenix palms have those spines. Okay. There's another clump. Now look at that Bismarckia. Man, is that showy. See, that's another one of those bottle palms. The original landscaper must have put those in when they built these houses in the 60s. But anyway, look at that Bismarckia. And there's a little privacy areca planting. Now I showed you this the other day from a distance. Look at how healthy these foxtails are. It's got them in the back. It's got them all around here. Both of these yards, they fertilize the yards pretty heavily, so they look really, really nice. They got great big heads on them. Look at the amount of seeds on that royal palm. Now all of those seeds are viable. So when they drop or the birds eat them, they can all start new fronds. But another interesting thing about, new trees. But an interesting thing, you see that frond's about to drop. That's what I was telling you. The beauty of these things is that they get really big. The problem is that they drop these huge fronds, so you want to put them away, really away from the house. Those are foxtails right there. Look how pretty that Bismarckia is in the back. Now this is the single fishtail that I mentioned to you when we were on the other street. This is a very, very poor example. It's dying from lack of fertilization, but it's a single trunk, and you almost never see that. You do see the clumping fishtail, but not that single one very often. This isn't a real good example, but that's a Phoenix. I think it's Sylvestris. Another interesting thing about those Phoenix palms is that they can cross-pollinate. So there are hybrids that are a mix of big ones and small ones. It just came to me though. I was telling you, I don't know the difference between that is that small one like that. That's Phoenix sylvestris. Dactylifera is the one that has that's a clumping palm, and is can be really really vicious. I mean, it has huge spines on it, and it clumps, so it gets really, you know, massive. The other thing is, all the seeds are viable, so when the birds eat them, the palms can be spread around. There's one in the back of my yard that's not actually on the neighbor's property, and I don't think they have any idea what a big issue is growing back there. We're gonna start back now, and let's see, I think the next tour we're gonna do is, we're just gonna do a walk around and identify a lot of tropical plants for you. Some that you might not otherwise see or have somebody identify for you, like those xanthosomas or those elephant ears. This is a really unusual philodendron with the leaves cut up like that. There's another philodendron up there. So I like talking about all of the different plants. Anyway, I got a little walk back to my house. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have, take the time to subscribe. It really helps out the channel. And I'll see you on the next video.